Simon & Schuster Audio presents Gabby, A Story of Courage and Hope by Mark Kelly and Gabrielle Giffords with Jeffrey Zaslow. Read by Mark Kelly and Gabrielle Giffords.
In memory of Christina Taylor Greene, Dorothy Morris, John Roll, Phyllis Schneck, Dorwin Stoddard, and Gabriel Zimmerman.
Chapter 1. The Beach. I used to be able to tell just what my wife Gabby was thinking. I could sense it in her body language, the way she leaned forward when she was intrigued by someone and wanted to soak up every word being said, the way she nodded politely when listening to some know-it-all who had the floor. The way she'd look at me, eyes sparkling, with that full-on smile of hers, when she wanted me to know she loved me. She was a woman who lived in the moment, every moment. Gabby was a talker, too. She was so animated, using her hands as punctuation marks, and she'd speak with passion, clarity, and good humor, which made her someone you wanted to listen to. Usually I didn't have to ask or wonder what she was thinking. She'd articulate every detail. Words mattered to her, whether she was speaking about immigration on the floor of the U.S. House of Representatives, or whether she was alone with me talking about her yearning to have a child. Gabby doesn't have all those words at her command anymore, at least not yet. A brain injury like hers is a kind of hurricane, blowing away some words and phrases and leaving others almost within reach but buried deep under debris or in a different place. "It's awful," Gabby will say, and I have to agree with her. But here's the thing. While Gabby struggles for words, coping with a constant frustration that the rest of us can't fathom, I still know what she's thinking much of the time. Yes, her words come haltingly or imperfectly or not at all, but I can still read her body language. I still know the nuances of that special smile of hers. She's still contagiously animated and usually upbeat, using her one good hand for emphasis. And she still knows what I'm thinking, too. There's a moment that Gabby and I are going to hold on to, a moment that speaks to our new life together and the way we remain connected. It was in late April 2011, not quite 4 months after Gabby was shot in the head by a would-be assassin. As an astronaut, I had just spent 5 days in quarantine awaiting the last launch of Space Shuttle Endeavor, which I'd be commanding. It was around noon on the day before the scheduled liftoff, and my 5 crew members and I had been given permission to see our spouses for a couple of hours one last time. We'd be meeting with our wives on the back deck of this old, run-down, 2-story Florida beach house that NASA has maintained for decades. It's on the grounds of the Kennedy Space Center, and there's even a sign at the dirt road leading to it that simply says, "The Beach House." The house used to have a bed that astronauts and their significant others would use for unofficial, romantic reunions. Now it's just a meeting place for NASA managers, and by tradition, a gathering spot where spouses say their farewells to departing astronauts, hoping they'll see them again. Twice in the space shuttle's 30-year history, crews did not make it home from their missions. And so after a meal and some socializing as a group, couples usually break away and take private walks down the desolate beach hand in hand. The 2,000-square-foot house is the only structure on the oceanfront for more than 25 miles, since NASA controls a huge chunk of Florida's space coast. Look in any direction and there's nothing but sand, seagulls, an occasional sea turtle in the Atlantic Ocean. It's Florida pretty much the way it was centuries ago. On our previous visit to this spot, the day before my shuttle mission in May 2008, Gabby and I were newlyweds, sitting in the sand, chatting about the mission, her upcoming election, and our future together. Gabby reminded me of how very blessed we both were. She often said that. She felt we needed to be very thankful for everything that we had, and we were. The biggest problem on our minds was finding time to see each other, given our demanding careers in separate cities. It seemed complicated then, the jigsaw puzzle that was our lives, but in retrospect, it was so simple and easy. We couldn't have imagined that we'd return for a launch 3 years later and everything would be so different. This time, Gabby entered the beach house being pushed in a wheelchair, wearing a helmet to protect the side of her head where part of her skull was missing. It had been removed during the surgery that saved her life after she was shot. While the others at the house had come in pairs, each astronaut with a spouse, Gabby and I showed up with this whole crazy entourage. Her mother, her chief of staff, a nurse, 3 U.S. Capitol police officers, 3 Kennedy Space Center security officers, and a NASA colleague assigned to look after Gabby for the duration of my mission. The support Gabby now needed was considerable, and certainly not what my fellow crew members expected in their final moments with their wives. Instead of an intimate goodbye and a secluded beach, this became quite the circus. It was a bit embarrassing, but the men of my crew and their spouses were 100% supportive. They understood. Gabby had just logged 16 arduous and painful weeks sequestered in a Tucson hospital and then a Houston rehab center. She had worked incredibly hard, struggling to retrain her brain and fight off depression over her circumstances. For her doctors and security detail to give their blessings and allow her to travel, this was how her coming out needed to be handled. My crewmates and their wives greeted Gabby warmly, and she smiled at all of them and said hello, though it was clear that she was unable to make real small talk. Some words and most sentences were still beyond her. Everyone was positive, but everyone noticed. As I watched Gabby try to navigate the social niceties, I was very proud of her. She had learned since her injury that it could sap her energy and her spirits to be self-conscious about her deficiencies or her appearance. So she had found ways to communicate by employing upbeat hand motions and that terrific smile of hers, the same smile that had helped her connect with constituents, woo political opponents, and get my attention. She didn't need to rattle off sentences to charm a bunch of astronauts and their wives. She just had to tap into the person she's always been. After we settled in at the beach house, I said to Gabby, "Want to go down to the ocean?" "Yes," she said. "Yes, swim in the ocean." Though Gabby grew up in Arizona, a daughter of the desert, she loves the ocean more than anyone I've ever known. She first saw the Pacific as a kid, traveling with her parents and sister through Mexico and Central America. They'd spend weeks at a time, driving up and down the Pacific coast in a station wagon or camper. She loved to swim, to look for shells, to people watch. Later, the Atlantic became equally alluring for her, including this stretch of beach where we walked and swam together before my previous space flights. On those visits, Gabby had enjoyed swimming well offshore. I admired how she engaged the other spouses so they all could shake off their nervousness over the risky missions ahead. She had just the right touch, embracing the duties that came with being the commander's wife, while also being completely down to earth and making everyone feel welcome. But this time, of course, she was dependent on the kindness of others. Her nurse took her into the bathroom and got her into her swimsuit. Though it was a warm day, she needed sweatpants and a jacket, since her injury leaves her cold so much of the time. Gabby helped dress herself the best she could using her left hand, but she was limited. Because she was shot in the left side of her brain, which partially controls the right side of the body, her right hand remained mostly useless and still, an appendage on her lap. When Gabby got out of the bathroom, those assisting her helped her into a special chair that emergency medical crews use when they have to carry people downstairs or out of the wilderness. It took 3 of them to lug her in that chair through the sand, step by step, 100 yards toward the ocean. It was low tide, which made for a longer walk. I knew exactly what Gabby was thinking on this awkward journey down from the beach house. She was thinking what I was thinking, how desperately we both long for the life we used to have together. When the chair reached the water's edge, I thanked the men who carried Gabby for their efforts, and they lowered her to the ground. We unstrapped her, and after we helped her to her feet, she was able to navigate the hard, wet sand, taking a few steps, leading slowly with her left leg. That's when our support team moved back on the beach, trying to keep a respectful distance so Gabby and I could be alone. In the days immediately after Gabby was injured, I'd considered stepping down as commander of the shuttle flight. I was unsure of whether I'd be able to focus completely on the mission and didn't know when Gabby would be leaving intensive care. But once she began improving and I returned to training, I found myself fantasizing about the possibility that Gabby would recover enough to join me on this beach on this day, the day before liftoff. That became a goal of ours. Now, here we were. It turned out to be a pretty amazing moment, a gift of serenity at a time when both of us were caught in the brightest of spotlights. The day before, millions of TV viewers had watched grainy, unauthorized footage of Gabby walking slowly and deliberately up a tarmac staircase and onto a plane in Houston to fly here for the launch. It had been taken by a cameraman in a distant, hovering news helicopter. Meanwhile, within 24 hours, 700,000 people were expected to descend on Central Florida's East Coast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.